pyogenic liver abscess. If you take the various symptoms, how many answer it as fever? Good guess. But doctor, fever and abdominal pain. But they have done a clear study. Which is more common between the two? Abdominal pain in 100%, 89 to 100%. Fever is 67 to 100%. Both of them are touching 100%, but 67 it starts from. So that is your bad luck. Now, cholecystectomy should not be done when there is an acute cholecystitis. You have to first treat the inflammation and then go for the bile duct surgery, which is an important principle. Ranson's criteria. What is the alternative answer other than option A? WBC count, but it is not being mentioned. That's the reason. D, LDH greater than 350 on admission is there in criteria, no? So LDH greater than 700 become automatically true. But age more than 55, not age more than 45. Okay, so it's not my frame of question, it is an examiner's frame. I think Kolar entrance or Cometke, I don't know which entrance it was. Delormis is basically rectal prolapse. Surgery is basically Delormis procedure. 2-year-old has got limping. How many answered it as congenital dislocation? Anybody? Are we are telling no doctor, telescope is absent, which is important for the CDH to be considered as a diagnosis. That is the point. So telescope is absent, Trendelenburg is positive. So that makes the cogs of error most likely to be the answer for this case. And generally they present by the time they begin ambulation and between age of 6 years. So ambulation means 2 years is by the time they will ambulate, no? First year they will ambulate. Trendelenburg is positive. They will also have a waddling gait like a bilateral congenital dislocation child. And there will be weak abductors in them and a prominent great trochanter. And decreased abduction because of the articulo-trochanteric distance, which is decreased. So this is the typical cogs of error angle is 60, normal angle is between 20 to 23 is what we need to appreciate. Peripheral nerves can withstand for about 3 hours. Similarly, what is the difference between axonotmesis, neurotmesis, all these nerve injury funda, you have to be very good. What is the rate of the regrowth of the nerve after injury, everything. Dropping of the right shoulder, inability to hunch the shoulders is basically the problem with sternocleidomastoid trapezius, which are innervated by the spinal accessory nerve, as all of you know. Now in the pars spinae, it is the intervertebral disc which is typically affected and also the vertebral body, the involvement with tuberculosis is basically called pars. Where is the ulnar nerve injured? Whenever there is any pisiform, triquetrum, hamate in 4th and 5th metacarpal injuries, they are the classical locations. Lot in the lunate is what we need to understand. Now whenever there is a both bones of the forearm fracture, what is the most appropriate thing that you wanted to do in that case? We need to do open reduction with internal fixation, which is the most important part of the treatment, and internal fixation is done by doing the plating is what need to be understood. Then what are the indications for intramedullary nailing also I leave to you for you to review. Then what is gallows traction? I think even recent Karnataka entrances, gallows, Brian's, different traction and pins and needles of orthopedics. Maheshwari, you have to be 100% sure. So both the fractured and the well femur are placed in a skin traction and the infant is suspended by this special frame which is called as the gallows traction. A little modification of that becomes the Brian's traction as what we have seen the last week Sunday test. Now median nerve palsy is the one which is associated with the lunate fracture. So ulnar nerve injury where, median nerve injury where in the carpal bone injuries. Fractures you have to be very sure about. Now pyogenic joint abscess occur whenever there is an osteomyelitis of the metaphysis in the case of the femur, proximal femur or a distal femur or the distal end of the tibia, not in the proximal end of the humerus. That is the relation between osteomyelitis and pyogenic arthritis. Now in club foot we have a equinovarus deformity. Buthalmos has a high intraocular pressure. Shield cataract, which is anteriorly located, is pathognomonic of the atopic dermatitis. Then gonorrhea, staphylococcus, cornibacterium, they are all known to invade the intact corneal epithelium. Then CRAVO versus CRVO. You should know all the differences. Where do you find cherry red spot? CRAVO. Where do you find flame shaped hemorrhages? CRVO. And what are the predisposing factors? That also is a common question in the tomorrow's exam. Now, electroretinogram, what is A wave and what is B wave? The leading edge of the A wave is produced by the photoreceptors, and A wave is basically followed by the B wave. A is the initial negative deflection followed by the B wave, which is a positive deflection in the electroretinogram. Retinitis pigmentosa lead to that bony spicule appearance, tunnel vision, electroretinogram, all these things you have to be 200% sure. Enlarged corneal nerves. Which conditions do you come across? I don't know whether you are able to appreciate or not. This is a typical appearance of an enlarged corneal nerve. So it can be found in the case of keratoconus or Fuchs and Rees-Buchler's corneal dystrophy, or acanthamoeba keratitis or corneal graft failure will lead to an enlarged corneal nerve, typically in ophthalmology. Infrared light typically leads to development of the cataract, which is called the glass blower's cataract, is what you have to remember. In ophthalmia neonatorum, where do you find the necrosis of the cornea? It is typically just below the center of the cornea in ophthalmia neonatorum. This was a question of the West Bengal state entrance. Then optic nerve, what is the length of the intraorbital portion of optic nerve? It is about 30 to 35 mm, 30 mm in fact, and 4 mm in diameter. Very, very tough is called as entrance exam. So, but there, maybe that is important when you become core ophthalmologist, definitely. But you are not core ophthalmologist now. Progressive unilateral sensory neural deafness. Whenever it is there, you should think of the acoustic neuroma. Then if you take vestibular neuronitis, generally it does not lead to any auditory symptoms. That is most important to remember, vestibular neuronitis. And whenever there is any auditory symptoms, it is not vestibular neuronitis. That is the important rule. Only vertigo will be there. Vestibular symptoms, not labyrinthine symptoms in vestibular neuronitis, which generally follows a viral infection. Fever, headache, nasal obstruction with the bilateral bulging of the septal nasal septum is a classical feature of the septal abscess, where there will be a throbbing nose pain, general malaise, fever, headache, etc., etc. Frey syndrome, numbness of the ear and facial nerve injury, any of them can be the complications whenever you do the superficial parotidectomy, is the point we need to appreciate. Because in superficial parotidectomy, unlike the deep, total parotidectomy, you are still retaining the secretory part. Hence, xerostomia is not a part of the complications if you have done a real superficial only parotidectomy. Now, Quincy's peritonsillar abscess, Killian's dehiscence is typically found between the thyropharyngeus part of the inferior constrictor and the cricopharyngeus muscle, which is also the part of the inferior constrictor muscle of the pharynx. Between the two you come across the Killian's dehiscence. A 35-year-old was operated. She has a dramatic improvement following the surgery. She had a conductive deafness, like a stapes or something is problematic, and that got operated. Following that, she has got nystagmus, hearing loss, and all the symptoms starting with sneezing. This is a classical story of one of the complications of the middle ear surgery, which can be perilymphatic fistula. So perilymphatic fistula, otherwise called labyrinthine fistula, is a communication between the inner fluid, inner ear fluid filled space and the air filled space of the middle ear whenever you operate on the middle ear. That's what we need to appreciate. So tinnitus, disequilibrium and a sensory neural hearing loss, they all become the complications. If you take the history, they will have disequilibrium everything, and any stapes surgery can be a predisposing factor. Head trauma, barotrauma, acoustic trauma, anything can lead to communication between the inner ear's fluid and the middle ear's air chamber, which is called perilymphatic fistula. So you keep a single speculum pneumatic compression you do, and that will because of this communication between inner and middle ear, that lead to the disequilibrium become reproduced if you happen to do with the pneumatic speculum. So that fistula test is also called Henny-Bird sign. This is once more a favorite question of the examiner. Henny-Bird sign, it is suggestive of what? It is suggestive of perilymphatic fistula is what need to be remembered. So this is a typical case of the vocal cord malignancy for which radio chemotherapy is considered to be the best option considering the stage of the disease. So this we earlier also discussed. When to do surgery, when to do chemo radiotherapy, when to do only radiotherapy. All these are the issues in vocal cord malignancy. Bilateral neck swellings are there and epistaxis is there. Eustachian tube opening, that is the, what is that space called as? Fossa of Rosenmüller. So, is it in that area only? Somewhere higher above it, okay. But anyway, cervical lymphadenopathy is there, right? Nasopharyngeal carcinoma is the one which need to be basically suspected given the clinical picture. Krukenberg is metastatic, not a primary ovarian tumor, is a very well known fact. This is a good question, doctor. One question, this twin sister of this question can come in tomorrow's exam. How do you differentiate missed abortion from threatened abortion, inevitable abortion, all kinds of abortion? So let us start from the point one. This is called empty sac. Gestational sac develops normally, but the embryonic part of the pregnancy is missing. This is called as empty sac. Then what is inevitable abortion? In this, the cervix has already dilated open, but the fetus has not yet been expelled, which is called as inevitable, but cervical os is open. Now what is a threatened abortion? In this, there is no significant pain and there is no cervical dilatation or any change in cervical consistency. Only presentation is vaginal bleeding during early pregnancy. Then you call it as a threatened abortion. We are threatened means we are not really beaten. We are being threatened that we may get beaten. Then comes the complete abortion. In this, vaginal bleeding is there, abdominal pain is there, even passage of the tissue also is there, and ultrasound finally will show empty uterus. That is what you typically come across. And there is no tenderness of cervix and cervical os is typically closed at the end of the complete abortion. Then incomplete abortion means vaginal bleeding is there, dilatation of cervical canal is there, passage of the products of conception is there, and the vaginal bleeding is very heavy. That is what you typically come across. Then missed abortion means there is no vaginal bleeding, no abdominal pain, no cervical changes, no passage of tissue, makes it a missed abortion. So these four kinds of abortion, which case cervical os is opened and closed, where it is the products of conception are delivered or not expressed, these are all the points of interest. Now endometriosis typically has got association with hyperprolactinemia. They found a lot number of women with endometriosis have an associated hyperprolactinemia. So that is the reason. What is the concept? Infertility which you see in endometriosis may not be really due to always the physical adhesions. It can be due to the associated hyperprolactinemia. That's the reason once we had an argument on the same floor. If the patient has endometriotic, has no endometriotic symptoms, only laparoscopically found to have few lesions, they want to operate them. So if she is not clinically normal, clinically not having dyspareunia or anything, only problem is infertility. Do you want to operate? No use. If she has no clinical symptoms, only infertility is there and only laparoscopically found lesions are there, no need. Because the infertility which you see in endometriosis is multifactorial. Adhesions are only one of the factors, is the point of interest. Then what is meant by luteinized unruptured follicle syndrome is one important entity which you need to know. In this there will be severe pelvic adhesions due to endometriosis, where the ovary is encased and the luteinized uncaptured, unruptured follicle is the one which you see. So it is also one of the consequence of, the egg is unable to jump out of the ovary because of the too many adhesions that have been formed due to the endometriosis, is basically called luteinized unruptured follicle syndrome, which is known to have an association with endometriosis. Then complete and partial mole, we need to know the differences. Complete mole has no fetal tissue and it is 48.6 XX in 90% and 10% 46 XY. Whereas partial mole, fetal tissue is present and chromosomal component is 69XXX or 69XXY is what we need to understand. How to deliver the head in the normal labor? So you must know flexion, internal rotation, extension, restitution, all the different ways by which our head is manipulated for us to be delivered into the cruel world. So engagement, descent with flexion, delivery by extension, delivery of the shoulders. So this is the typical progression which we need to remember. So finally, the fetal head reaches the maternal symphysis pubis and it is being delivered by extension is what need to be remembered. The one question on Maidlener, Pomeroy, Uchida, you must be very sure on different brands of red wine available. What is the difference between one and the other? What do you do in each of the things, though we don't anymore do them? So that is called as a topic called tubectomy. So Dr. Pomeroy technique, 2 to 4 pregnancies for 1000 procedures. It has got a typically low rate. Currently the very common methods we do is Pomeroy, bipolar cautery and Filch's clip. So I'll give you failure rate, ectopic pregnancy rate in both of them. What is Mayer, Rokitansky, see Kushner-Hausner, doctor, ovary is there, X karyotype is there, but Mullerian agenesis is there, hence there is absence of the uterus, that is what you see. So you have ovaries present, absent uterus, uterine anomalies, phenotypically they are female only, not male, even genotypically they are basically female is what we need to know. Fish Hugh Curtis is typically seen with chlamydial infection. Earlier days gonococcal, but now chlamydia being more common than gonococcal, gonococcal is most common cause of the Fish Hugh Curtis. Now HCG typically is elevated in case of the Down syndrome because the cytotrophoblasts of a Down syndrome placenta produces high levels of the HCG is what need to be remembered. Now why the women who had obstructed labor with the vesicovaginal fistula, they show the presence of amenorrhea? It is considered to be a hypothalamic amenorrhea, is the underlying pathophysiology of the amenorrhea which you see in vesicovaginal fistula. In the medulla of the ovary we have the hyalous cells which are the counterpart of the interstitial cells of the Leydig is what you need to remember. Everything about trichomonas, one question generally comes on trichomonas. Now my question to you is, does trichomonas have a cyst? No, trichomonas does not have any cyst and the organisms can be able to survive for up to 24 hours in the urine, semen or even water sample. So that is the capability of trichomonas. All other organisms need cyst to survive the environment, they don't need. So that is the speciality of the trichomonas vaginalis. Cervical cancer will finally cause the blockade of the ureter leading to obstructive uropathy, where uremia is the most common cause of the mortality in the hands of a nephrologist, is what we need to understand. Prostate, breast, thyroid, all of them are hormone dependent malignancies. First trimester of pregnancy, 16 to 8 centimeters of ovarian cyst is there. What is the best thing that you want to do? The best time to operate is in the second trimester, ideally between 14 to 16 weeks. And anything above 6 centimeters need to be operated, because that can undergo rupture in the pregnancy. Mucal translucency is seen in Downs, which is trisomy 21. Folic acid, you need to basically start it preconception, actually speaking, before conception only. Out of the options given, first trimester becomes the best. Now, management of preeclampsia would be suction evacuation and termination of the pregnancy. Sheehan's is postpartum pituitary necrosis. And when will alcohol will have maximum effect on the fetus? So, 3rd to 9th week is the time, most vulnerable time for the fetus to get affected. DIC is very common in abruptio placentae, so which is painless, painful bleeding, all these things are important. Then we call first generation OCPs containing more than 50 milligrams of ethinyl estradiol, second generation between 30 to 35 mg, and third generation has got disogestrel and gestodine is what we need to appreciate. Histosalpingogram can help you to know the tubal patency. And metropathia hemorrhagica cystic glandular hyperplasia is associated. We give cabergoline, which is the dopamine receptor agonist at the D2 level, D2 receptor, which will lead to suppression of the lactation typically. Then if you do ovariectomy before 6 weeks of pregnancy, why the pregnancy get affected? Because the first 6 weeks of pregnancy, progesterone produced by the corpus luteum, which is there in the ovary, maintains pregnancy. If ovariectomy had been done, corpus luteum is not there, progesterone is not there, pregnancy won't stand. So that's the reason pregnancy definitely get affected. Stain Levanthal, one of the criteria is presence of the multiple ovarian cysts. And always, what is the rule in heart disease, doctor? All stenotic lesions worsen in pregnancy, all regurgitant lesions improve in pregnancy. Because pregnancy lead to vasodilation, fall of peripheral resistance. Hence, if there is a regurgitant lesion, low peripheral resistance means forward flow. So regurgitation become lesser, because peripheral resistance kam ho gaye to aorta will permit forward flow rather than reverse flow. But stenotic lesions will worsen. Why stenotic lesions will worsen? When the peripheral resistance is low, then the blood circulates very fast. So that fastly circulating blood will find impedance with the stenotic lesion and lead to development of a early decompensation. So stenotic lesions like mitral stenosis, aortic stenosis, PDA, coarctation of aorta, they will all worsen. Whereas aortic regurgitation like lesions typically will improve with pregnancy is what need to be remembered. Dermoid cyst is the ovarian cyst which is well known to lead to torsion. What is meant by primary oocyte and secondary oocyte? Typically, primary oocytes form before birth and secondary oocytes typically form at the time of the ovulation. So you must know what are the differences between the karyotypes of different steps of oogenesis on which questions can come. So that ends our journey, doctor. Once more, arise, awake, and fight until the last breath. That should be the goal before an exam. No way you take back, because you all did good effort with different degrees of compassion. Doesn't matter. Thank you, doctor.